Hi, and welcome back to the Nerd Leading the Nerd. I'm Seth. This is Drew. And before we get started, if you like this content, please like, share, subscribe, hit the little bell icon. We're starting to branch out a little bit from these main episodes and post some kind of sub content, some unboxings, things of that nature. So if you want to be informed when we're doing extra stuff, just hit the bell. Today, we are going to talk about yet another suggestion from our commenters. That is going to be the Pagemaster, near and dear to my 90s kid heart.
Yeah. And so in true traditional fashion, I'm going to go ahead and take a peek over here at IMDb and read the fun little synopsis. So the Pagemaster is described as a cowardly boy who buries himself in accident statistics, enters a library to escape a storm, only to be transformed to an animated illustration by the Pagemaster. He has to work through obstacles from classic books to return to real life. Absolutely spot on.
Yeah.
Couldn't have said it better myself.
Yeah, I agree. Very, very thorough synopsis.
This is a movie that, as Seth said, very near and dear to, you know, the heart of a 90s child. And it's got Macaulay Culkin in it. It's got Christopher Lloyd in it. So, I mean, just two pillars of that time frame of that era of nostalgia. The movie starts out just like the description says. This kid, Macaulay Culkin, his name is Richard Tyler Rich, which really all I could think of was Macaulay Culkin in Richie Rich every time someone called him Rich. But that's besides the point. His dad's building him a treehouse. And all he's doing is spouting off these statistics. He's like, well, you know that there's a, you know, 7% chance that, you know, accidents happen at the home. And then there's a 4% chance where accidents are going to happen on a ladder. That's an 11% probability. And what happens? Of course, something goes wrong. Dad falls out of the treehouse, confirming the fears of this child.
So, he also has little posters all over his room, like no smoking, high voltage next to the power outlet. He's got
The future makings of an OSHA regulator for sure.
Yeah. And or just super OCD adult that never leaves their home. He then is asked by his dad to go get some nails from the hardware store. And this just like epic storm breaks out.
Yeah. He goes, out of nowhere, too.
Just seemingly out of nowhere. He goes into that tunnel. I made a note. If I was him, I would have just stayed in the tunnel and waited out the storm. But for whatever reason, he keeps going and makes his way to this library. Epic library, by the way.
Hello?
Welcome to the library, young man.
I would love to go to a library like that.
Yeah. Just,
I could smell the books. When he walked in there, I had that rush of like, you know, old parchment, you know, bound books. I don't know. And maybe that's my adult brain kicking in because I've had some of those experiences. But I was like, okay, yeah, this is good. I like this. I got little tingles and jingles. It was great.
Yeah, it had like big murals on the walls, and it was just a great aesthetic. He becomes a cartoon and goes on a few different adventures where he ultimately gets to the exit. They keep referring back to the emergency exit sign, and he eventually makes his way out. I wanted to give everyone a little, just again, this little spark notes beginning to end in case you haven't seen this movie, but I had seen this movie. I don't know if you had, Drew, but when I was a kid, I watched this several times. A big Macaulay Culkin fan.
Of course. See, I didn't watch this as a kid. I remember my story that with this movie is the iconic trailer for this movie, which is pretty short. It was on a VHS that I played constantly. So I kept seeing all the advertisements for this movie. I forget which VHS it was or what DVD it was, but I remember the trailer vividly, and I'm like, man, this seems right up my alley. This seems like the movie for me. I'm really excited about it. And then fast forward to, I don't know, I'd say maybe my late 20s. And I was like, screw this. I really want to watch this movie. I never got to see it as a kid. I watched it on, I bought it on Amazon Prime because I'm like, I'm going to love this movie. First viewing, I did not like this movie. I was really so let down by it. And it's because I think the trailer and the buildup gave me higher expectations. But rewatching it now, absolutely, totally different thought process, totally different feel to it. I really liked it. I really liked it this go around because I didn't have any expectations. I didn't have any high hopes. And I think that's the problem. Like sometimes you watch these trailers and they elevate your expectations. Then you go see the movie and you're kind of let down. And it's like, okay, well, yeah, I know it was fine, I guess, but that's not what you were hoping for. So second viewing or third viewing, whatever it was, definitely liked it a lot better.
The good of this movie, in my opinion, is just all the literary references.
Yes.
Easter eggs. I have personally read Treasure Island. I don't know if it was last year or the year before. Really, really enjoyed that book. So I hadn't read that when I was a kid watching this. So that was a big difference there, like knowing all the Treasure Island references and Long John Silver and all that stuff. Like, I really enjoyed that.
Not the seafood chain, but the actual
person,
actual person.
But yeah, I really enjoyed that. And, you know, if you looked when I mentioned Easter eggs, when you're in the library or even other parts of the movie, like when they're in the horror section, as example, like you saw like a couple of Stephen King titles, like The Shining, there was Salem's Lot. Yeah. I really enjoyed that. I never noticed any of that as a kid, obviously. For me, the bad of this movie, and again, I never noticed this as a kid, but I did notice that when he became a cartoon character, Macaulay Culkin didn't have a ton of lines. It's almost like he went into the recording studio and recorded this entire movie in less than 8 hours or something. He had like a couple of little like, hey, like kind of shouts and things like that. And then a couple of lines. But I think there was not. Did you notice that there wasn't a ton of Macaulay Culkin recorded character banter?
And I think it's, well, okay, if you look at the other three, so there's the trio of books that follow him around that become a part of his story. Those are some big name actors. So Adventure is Patrick Stewart, which I don't hear it. I don't know why.
I don't either. I don't either.
Because I love Patrick Stewart. I love when he does animated stuff. I especially love him on American Dad, because some of the things that he says are absolutely hilarious and not what you would expect from what you would, you know, he's very British, you know. And so,
he's been knighted, I think.
Well, that I don't know, but we can check and post that here. Or let us know in the comments.
Yeah.
he's done a lot of Shakespearean stuff. So honestly, I was, you kind of get caught up in everything as he's Adventure. I wasn't hearing it, and I expected like, oh, well, he'll probably, you know, maybe they'll get to like a sci-fi section and then he'll pop in, or they'll get to, you know, he'll be, you know, in Moby Dick or something, you know, some sort of literary, you know, piece of material of significance. But no, that was just me being weird. Frank Welker is the voice of Horror, and he's done, I mean, a massive amount of stuff. He is in Scooby-Doo. He would do a lot of like other animations, you know, from like Looney Tunes, Animaniacs, you know, just weird stuff. Like, he's one of those voice actors that just kind of keeps popping up in certain things. He's Shockwave in some of the Transformers projects. So, I mean, he's done a lot of different stuff. And then you have Whoopi Goldberg as Fantasy, which, you know, at the time, I mean, you've got, you know, Patrick Stewart, you got Whoopi Goldberg. They were both in Star Trek together. There's a third. Okay. Did you catch the third Star Trek character in this movie.
I did not. Please do tell.
Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Did you catch the voice?
I didn't catch the voice. I looked at who played what, and I didn't recognize that person.
Okay. Leonard Nimoy plays Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Leonard Nimoy is Spock from Star Trek, the original series.
Okay.
Yeah. When in some of his older work, he has dentures and you can hear
a little
whistle-ish thing happening. Yeah. So I can see why there'd be a little bit of a disconnect, but I mean, absolutely loved it. And I'm sure there's other folks that have been a part of Star Trek that maybe in, you know, some of these, like, I don't think Ed Begley Jr. was in Star Trek, or Star Wars, but either way, I thought that was cool. I thought that was great to see a couple of, you know, Trekkies get together for a project like this. Those are the people that they're going to give most of the lines to. Macaulay Culkin, yeah. He's still a kid. He gets to be in the movie physically and have interactions with Christopher Lloyd, which is really cool. Loved Christopher Lloyd. Very spooky. Expected him to be a bad guy. He wasn't, which is great.
Yeah.
I get that. I get why he was kind of an afterthought, which is a shame because Macaulay Culkin's a great actor in his own right.
I mean, that was at a time when he was a big name for a child and whatnot.
Yeah.
What was
he was like the child actor of the 90s.
Oh yeah, 100%. What was your favorite part?
Favorite part, I would say anything involving Christopher Lloyd, whether he was in person or as the Pagemaster himself, like the wizard Pagemaster look. I don't know, man, like he really made the movie for me as much as I loved everybody else as a part of it. In the beginning, when he's talking to, you know, Macaulay Culkin and he like first walks into the library, he's all disheveled. He doesn't know what's going on. And he's like, I know what you need. You need adventure. You need horror. You need fantasy. Like all of that bit. I was like, yes, I need all of these things. Thank you, Christopher. And the quick, you know, close up magic, whatever, where he's like, bah, and he like pops up the library card, and you're just like, whatever you say, man.
That whole library and that library card made me want to get a library card. Right now. Like I need to get a library.
Well, I have a library card, but none of the libraries around me are that cool. I want to find a library that's that cool, and I want to go to it, and I want to check out at least three books. But that was my Christopher Lloyd made the movie for me. And okay, I will also say as a secondary favorite of the movie, Macaulay Culkin's bike. I wanted bike as a kid. So cool. Like everyone's making fun of him for it. I loved it. I wanted that bike. All the like beep boop stuff on there. I wanted it. I thought it was so cool.
Yeah. I agree. Very, very
What about you? Favorite part?
My favorite part, I've made it clear. But, you know, maybe this is folks first time watching our show. I'm a huge fantasy nerd. I loved, even as a kid and, you know, watching it to this day, when Macaulay Culkin put on like the skeletons, the dead adventurers, like helmet, he grabbed the shield and the sword and he was like going to slay the dragon.
That was a good moment.
Loved it. And then ultimately got eaten by the dragon and used the Jack and the Beanstalk book to get out of the dragon. I just thought
that was cool.
Very good. I love that part and it didn't change as an adult. I absolutely just adored it. Back to Christopher Lloyd really, really quick. I also, a favorite like moment was when Macaulay Culkin comes to and he's like, you took a bad spell. And he's looking up at the mural on the ceiling and it's the Pagemaster Christopher Lloyd in the center and Christopher Lloyd as the librarian's head pops up over. I really liked that.
So great.
That shot was amazing. I really, really enjoyed that, but I would be curious to know if there's something that you would change about this movie.
Ooh, I don't know. Okay. And in the spirit of being able to change something, and we already talked about this, like maybe give Macaulay Culkin a little bit more of a presence in the animated world, but also, and I know this is a kid's movie, so this might be like kind of like straddling the line. He needed to slay the dragon. He needed to take it down. Like everything that he does throughout the course of his adventure is great. And he is battling a lot of inner turmoil, and he comes out better for it on the other side. But there's nothing specific that he really achieves. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I would have absolutely loved it if, like, he fights the dragon, gets swallowed, he has the sword, and does the whole, like, you know, as the beanstalk is, like, growing up, because that's a great moment. He, like, grabs the sword and sticks it into the dragon and just splits him, like, right up the middle. And then the dragon just, like, falls away as he goes up.
He fillets the, like, dragon.
Yeah. And then, like, and what would have also been really, really cool is, like, he gets a little cut on his cheek. You know what I mean? And that turns into a scar. Like, he gets a cut as an animated character. It's on him in real life. So that's, like, the, oh, it really happened. Like, oh, my gosh. Like, this wasn't just a dream, you know, like, oh, this was amazing. Like, that would have been really cool. And plus, I think it would have been, like, that constant reminder of, you know, it's okay to be brave. It's okay to, you know, think about fantasy stuff and be really into that side of stuff. Like, don't, like, yeah, the world is a horrible, terrible place, but it's okay to be brave every now and again. Like, I would have really liked that. I thought it would have made a great little moment, but it is a kid's movie, so you don't want to get too deep, I guess.
Yeah, that's a good point. I would argue, though, that what he accomplished was he conquered himself. He didn't have to conquer the dragon because he conquered himself in mustering enough courage to go on those adventures and not just shut down and lay in the fetal position and wait to be rescued by the Pagemaster. So, but I agree. It would have been cool to see him slay. I saw a bit of myself in that character with the sword at the end, you know, like wanting to slay the dragon. And I loved that kind of stuff as a kid and to this day. So the only thing I would change, this is like so random, but it always bothered me as a kid. And it bothered me when I rewatched it, when at the end he's like sleeping in the treehouse and the parents are like, should we bring him inside? And they're like, no, just let him sleep.
Yeah.
There's like that big opening in the treehouse. And all I could think about was that he's going to roll off out of that treehouse. So yeah, I would have probably just had a door installed, but see, that's just me. I fell out of the top of a bunk bed as a kid. So that hit me.
So that's the built-in fear for you.
Yeah. Yeah. That hit me hard when they just left him in that treehouse.
I thought the same thing. I also thought, like, okay, and this is the pessimist in me. I'm like, okay, so, you know, it starts to rain. The kid gets sick. He falls out of the tree, and that completely undoes absolutely everything. And like the books get wet and they get ruined. And then, cause they're already like kind of rough looking in real life. And so like the books get ruined. The parents are like, these are mildewy. We're going to throw these out. They throw the books out. The kid's sick. He ends up catching pneumonia. And then, you know, he ends up like in the hospital. Everything's undone. The kid is even worse. He's living in a bubble now. Like, I'm glad that didn't happen. But I was like, man, this kid is like 10 minutes in a cold rainstorm away from having all this whole movie being absolutely meaningless.
I agree.
That's just me. That's just me.
Yeah. There needs to be a follow up to this movie about what happened to his character as an adult based on these experiences as a child. Yeah. But, you know, I don't, maybe that's for us to write and shoot a short
little fanfic. Our list of fanfic is growing at this point for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. In closing, I enjoyed this movie thoroughly. I love revisiting these movies that I loved as a kid. So thanks again for the comment and the suggestion. It was completely off our radar, not even close to being on our list of movies that we were going to cover on this season. So keep the suggestions coming. We love the interaction. So
absolutely.
From all of us here at The Nerd Leading the Nerd, come back soon.
We'll be waiting.